Hey everyone, how's it going? Blue-Eyed Samurai held my attention, but how did it do this? What made this series stand out, and why do I think you should watch it? The first aspect, which really brings you into Blue-Eyed Samurai, is, of course, the visuals. It's like seeing color for the first time. The palette is vibrant, and the tones contrast beautifully with an otherwise gritty Japan during the Edo period. You'll notice the application of 3D elements right off the bat. Artists are only ever getting better with merging the traditional 2D anime style with heightened dimensions. It's a huge benefit when it comes to capturing the scope and space of an environment. Blue Spirit, the French-American animation studio which made this series, spent a ridiculous amount of time ironing out the choreography of the characters in relation to their environments. As a result of this, it feels so much more immersive and cinematic. This is thanks to a technique called parallaxing. Since early doors, artists have strived to create depth in their visuals. What started as cells on an old animated storyboard has become a vast array of digital and generative techniques which artists can use to capture the director's vision. The environment and actions of the characters in this series is of course all pre-visualized. It's what gives you that fluidity and that detail. Similarly to the facial animations of these characters in Blue Eye, the level of realism might make you think this was done by rotoscoping or motion cap, when in fact it was just computer generated. The animators used pre-recorded footage for the stunts, the actions, and of course the acting in order to simulate that accuracy you would get from an actor. There's moments in this show that make me relate to the characters. You know, seeing someone's eyes bulge out of their head when they get stabbed by a katana. Yeah, visceral. I feel your pain, man. Many people would compare the art style and narrative flow of this series with Arcane, which is a show I am a massive fan of. I think we just have to come to terms with the fact that French animation studios are on a completely different level. From the use of composited particles to the seamless in-betweens, and of course incredible framing, each shot of this show just looks like a painting. On many occasions throughout Blue Samurai, the depth of field and focal length is used to enhance the character's emotional states, with the characters tossing and turning as the simulated camera follows the momentum of their actions. All of the fights hold so much emotional weight, and you can see this really clearly in the imagery. There's clearly a lot of resemblance and homages to great filmmakers of the past, especially Akira Kurosawa, who is essentially the grandfather of Japanese filmmaking, if not filmmaking in general. Elements of Ran and Yojimbo shine in the series, and it solidifies Blue Eye as a technical marvel. Now, let me hit you with that soundtrack. Come on now, I mean, how can you not like this? Incorporating modern music into a historical piece can be kind of jarring sometimes, but there is something about seeing a samurai train to AC/DC that, yeah, it just feels right. And going on a rampage to From Whom the Bell Tolls, it kind of reminded me of how the soundtrack is incorporated in Guardians of the Galaxy, although it is non-diegetic in Blue Samurai, meaning it's not part of the scene, which would make a lot of sense. This is Edo period Japan. Although, I'm sure the Shogun would probably like AC/DC. As much as I like original scores and how fed up I am of seeing random pop music just thrown into random trailers, I gotta admit, if the music is right and it works, then go for it. If you're enjoying this video so far, feel free to hit that subscribe button. I really do appreciate it. The story has an effective build-up which introduces the audience to the core conflict of this vicious world. In this society where Japan was completely closed off from the West, the concept of a non-Japanese person is shown to be completely impure, and thus our protagonist is demonized. This immediately adds complexity to the story because our character is placed in an awkward position where they have little to absolutely no power in regards to what's going on in general society. It is far beyond the control of a single person. This show is primarily about a brooding, lonesome warrior who is searching for the man who has essentially ruined their life. Mizu is one of the best written characters I've seen in a good long time. Intellectually, we are of course aware that the story is tailored to Mizu's journey, Blue-Eyed Samurai makes sense. We are given droplets of Mizu's past at the perfect moments in the story, which correlates with the current events, especially in episode 5, which is as heartbreaking as it is intense. My infatuation with Mizu as a character came from their desperation to keep their secrets hidden. Their wish to hide themselves from others is only overshadowed by their desire for revenge. It definitely had me wondering why Mizu is the way that they are. Mizu is convention breaking, and if you're ever thinking about writing a powerful character whose worth is dictated by their actions as opposed to pandering exposition, Mizu is a fantastic option to study and learn from. The supporting cast provides an intertwining web of ideals which all correlate to Mizu's actions, but they do very little to stop Mizu's relentless journey. Each character holds a trait which is very unique and special to them, and it directly correlates to the overall theme of the story, which is to find your purpose in such a corrupted, deprived world, where women are looked down upon and treated like nothing, where men are fueled dangerously with their pride, and foreigners are completely demonized. My two favorite episodes is kind of a mini arc in itself, and that's episodes 4 and 5 in the Brothel District. Madame Kanji's monologue to Mizu came as a surprise to me. It shines a light on how quote-unquote peculiarities should be celebrated, and that's more so a Western ideal as opposed to Far Eastern. In Japan, especially at this time, it was very much about the nail getting hammered down to focus and be a part of society, to not be an outspoken individual. Apparently, the animators treated these sex scenes as fight scenes, which, to be fair, is near enough the same thing. I find when sex and nudity is involved with films, it can be pretty egregious. It's kind of there maybe for absolutely no reason whatsoever, but you know what? In this, it's done really tastefully, and it actually adds to the story. For me, it's kind of rolled back to that idea of interpreting wholeness by literally stripping people down and kind of exposing their human side. That's my take on it. Akemi is a character whose journey parallels Mizu's, although on a complete different side of the spectrum and hierarchy. Though her affiliation with royalty gives the story a completely different viewpoint when the narrative shifts over to her perspective. There is a stark contrast between the livelihoods of these characters, but it's the bringing together which creates the emotional arcs of the story. I especially love the relationship between Akemi and Taigen. Although they don't get that much screen time, you can clearly see their ideologies and principles do a full 180 as the show ends. On the complete flip side, we have Ringo. Ringo is as wholesome as they come and is probably the complete opposite of Mizu. He essentially becomes Mizu's self-appointed apprentice. I'll admit, I found him a tiny bit annoying at first because I got concerned that, oh no, they've brought in this goofy comedic relief character, but it only lasted for a split second because then I realized this guy's actually interesting. I kind of like him. He doesn't overstep, and it's always a fun experiment to partner two very different people, because Ringo looks to Mizu in a very singular light. He sees Mizu as this honorable lone samurai. He almost glorifies them. But the closer the two get over the series, the more he sees Mizu's darker side, and then that's when his brain switches and is like, oh my god, the world is kind of flawed. And that's after he had his hands cut off. Ringo's character kind of reminded me of a child slowly maturing and realizing that the world isn't the nicest is placed, but Ringo's core strength comes from his moral compass, so I'm interested to see if they do anything more with him in the next season. The level of detail in the scripture, the world building, the costumes is incredible, which obviously makes sense for a period show, but it also embraces the fluidity and creative scope of animation, the embellishment of animation, alongside including Western elements in the themes, which is that the idea of individuality is a fantastic thing. And it's also good because this idea doesn't get paraded throughout the show, it doesn't get pushed beyond the point of necessity, it doesn't come across as woke or some kind of forced agenda. To me, these themes were perfectly balanced and gave the story the driving factor it needed. Thank you for watching this video. If you did enjoy, feel free to hit that subscribe button. I recommend anyone to watch Blue-Eyed Samurai. It's a captivating story, and I can't wait for more. Seriously, it needs to come out. I need more.